So, does anyone else agree? Isn't society so strange? We can dive out of planes, jump off of bridges, but we can't seem to say the word rape. Yes, rape. Not sexual assault and not a bad one-night stand. Worse, when we are talking about rape, we are talking about that hard homework assignment or even that football game we lost last week. Not about the trauma I felt my freshman year, and not about the trauma hundreds of other people feel day in and day out. So, this is my story, a story I finally get ownership of. It was his formal. I was actually pretty excited. I had just borrowed my friend's dress. It was cut above the knee. The neckline showed a little skin. Not too much, not too little. Something I was comfortable with. Isn't that what matters? So before I start, I want to set one narrative straight. My dress did not determine my fate. And I for sure was not asking for it. The next morning, I woke up in my dorm room in all of his clothes, but no recollection of the night prior. I made up excuse after excuse. There was no way. He had violated me, stripped me of my virginity, and changed my life forever, all while I was blacked out and not coherent. But unfortunately, this was the truth. Hi. I am Kelsey Nass, and yes, I was raped on a cold winter night of my freshman year. Now, if you had initially asked me what had happened, I would have just said it was a hookup. I was confused, and I was in deep denial. Then with time and slow validation, I could even call it sexual assault. But today, I'm able to stand before you all, able to utter the word rape. So, after this had all happened, I am left feeling confused, helpless, and alone, desperately in need of some kind of next steps. Are there any appropriate next steps? But I do consider myself lucky. Unlike a lot of people who have been raped, I was able to pair some kind of weak title to what had happened to me, giving me that push to call the Center for Women and Community, which is a mental health service on this campus. We played phone tag for around a month, then one day I picked myself up, I walked myself over and made an appointment. I saw them for around a year. I am nothing but grateful for these services. But it came to a point where these services were not enough. In the midst of all this, my rape kept resurfacing, and I was realizing it was not going anywhere. And women started coming to me looking for support. But we all needed support. We all needed that next step, and I was willing to be that voice. I decided to go to a higher up, more authoritative figure, solely with the initiative to implement educational programs and projects on this campus to help end the ongoing issue of sexual assault and rape. It was pretty harmless. I was met with an evident battle of power. Now the question was, who was going to win? Meek? Little bright-eyed girl with a story that could make headlines, or the person sitting across from me who gets a check with a multitude of zeros, a check that says in bold, you have a reputation to uphold. I am your firsthand account of how this battle unfolded. It was in his office. I was feeling pretty confident. I knew my facts, I knew my story, and most important, I knew my initiative solely for change. I was met with the words, this will all be on record, and I do not need and or want details of your full story. Within minutes, my confidence was stripped. I was being looked at as a court case, further than that, a liability. I was a threat to his power, power he was dangling right before my eyes. Then I was met with a method I like to call the conveyor belt. It's pretty simple. It's where you take me and my story, and you pass us from place to place, putting the burden of my situation onto someone else, and taking it out of the hands of the person I chose to confide in. In my case, I was offered psychological services, Center for Women Community, which I've already seen. I was even told I could report to the police if I really wanted to, all inevitably on my own. They wanted to change me and not what had happened to me. Mental health services, as I said prior, were critical to helping me find a path to heal. But mental health services are not going to end this ongoing issue. So after I just went through the degrading method of the conveyor belt, I was then brought to the lowest point I had felt throughout this meeting. He had proposed a program to me that he said that he'd been working on campus. It would kind of go like this. It'd be me sitting across from the man who had raped me. I would explain to him the implications of his actions of that night and the effect they had on me. Then we were supposed to come to amends. Yes, amends, where I would excuse all the criminal act he did to my body that night and be expected to move forward. But that was just not an option.
That's right.
Yeah. We put the perpetrators in timeout, waiting for this to happen again and again. So, congratulations. You have made it through my story. So, can we all be in agreement that this should not happen to anybody else? Yes. So, why am I here? To propose two solutions to you. One starting with the university level, one the societal. So, for the university, why was I proposed this program? A program that was not going to work. Something as simple as a Google search with the word sexual assault awareness, sexual assault support, multiple results pop up. Why are these programs not promoted? Are we embarrassed? Do we fear bringing light to this issue? Or worse, are these not actually functioning programs? Are they just for show? Before I'd walked into that office, he already had his own predetermined judgment on not just me, on all people like me in my situation. He had cut me off before I had even started. The reasoning, it doesn't really matter. It could have been from how he was raised or what side of the bed he woke up on in the morning. Through his careful word choice and tiptoeing around my situation, I was evidently able to see the judgment he had associated with me. And this brings me to my next solution. On a societal level, it is time to think about the power of our words. How can a singular word have such deep meaning? We use softer, more comfortable terms because it makes our situations not seem as bad, easier to hide from. But I have chose not to hide. When we use a term, when we use a term sexual assault rather than rape, we are softening all the pain and trauma someone endures when this has happened. Perhaps the raw, pure form of the word rape officially validates your situation and you can no longer hide. And yes, that is scary. How do you perceive someone who has been raped? How do you see me? Am I still that young, bubbly girl who walked on stage minutes ago? Or am I now redefined by my story? Am I Kelsey Nass, a sophomore at UMass Amherst, majoring in integrated marketing communications, whose favorite ice cream flavor is peanut butter swirl and really hates scary movies? Or do you perceive me different because I uttered the word rape? Even if you do, even if you do not, I now exist with three different labels. I am either the victim, the liability, or even the survivor. What am I to you? Now, it's okay. Don't be embarrassed. If you categorize me into one of these labels, it's human. But I'm here to tell you the power of a label and how your judgment stripped me of my validation process. I will take you with me as I explain what these labels mean, the effect they had on me, and most important, what I did about it. The victim, a label that really does seem so harmless. If I was not the perpetrator, then yes, of course, I was the victim. It really is that simple, right? People who tend to pair me with this label are people who just got wind of my story, They heard it through the grapevine. They did not hear it from me. They know my name, they know some form of my story, and that is the furthest step of action and support they are going to take. These people visualize me as my past. They see me as my story. And worse, they assume I see myself in the same lens. This label is the softest version of validation. It is paired with weakness and defeat. When I am left feeling like the victim, I walk around this campus with my head down. My head down and embarrassed of who knows my story. This label has hampered me from grabbing opportunities that I have worked so hard to get. When I am left feeling like the victim, it brings me back to that night in December, where I did not have control of my body. And now, I don't have control of my label. A label that is so powerful made me feel so powerless. You do not have to call me a victim for me to feel this way. The liability. Obviously a label I am pretty familiar with. The people who tend to pair you with this label are your higher up officials. They see the negative outcome of your situation and how it will impact their power and position. They let their own predetermined judgment take the wheel and how they are going to act towards you and how they are going to support you. When I am left feeling like the liability, it reminds me of his office and that follow-up email he had promised me. An email I wait for every day. An email that is not coming. Something as simple as a follow-up email would have made me feel like a human being and not a liability. So, can we change this predetermined judgment? Is that possible? Honestly, not really. All we can do is be aware, think about the impacts it had on me and the impacts it has on so many other people. When you pair me with this judgment, not only does it take away my confidence, it blurs my hope. My hope of seeing an end to this crippling culture. My hope of who stands with me and not against me. Now, I bet you think I am forgetting something, the beloved title of survivor. How do you expect me to feel like a survivor when society tells me otherwise? How do you expect me to validate what had happened to me when no one else can? But with time, I realized, I don't need you to tell me I'm a survivor. I don't need you to give me a label at all. I already know I survived. I am alive, and I am breathing. Of course, I survived. But how can you show me this? You can confide in me with things in and out of the realm of sexual assault and rape. You can educate me on ways to advocate for people who need a helping hand. You can hold more events and open conversations that are paired with a trigger warning, because when things are triggering, it means they are not talked about enough. And most important, you can give me more platforms such as these, a platform where I can share my story, a story that may make you cringe, feel saddened, or maybe even empowered. Now, on a university level, it is time to revamp your standards for your faculty. Professionals who are in charge of a social climate need to be equally proficient in how to talk to someone who has been raped as they are in making Excel spreadsheets. Sorry. They need to be trained in the right ways to act and support someone in my position. Come to me from a comforting angle and do not look at me as a liability. My rape was not a business deal, so let's not turn it into one. For me, I still struggle with these labels every day and the stigma tied to them. I am the president of my sorority to advocate for women who feel silenced, silenced by the labels of victim and liability. I am not their voice. I am just an outlet to help them share their story and mold a path to heal. I let them know they are strong and they have the brightest futures ahead. They are still known for their contagious laughs, good grades, and even being the flyer of their high school cheerleading team. I help facilitate my own open conversations on sexual assault and rape on this campus to help build a safer community. When people lead these conversations, they come up to me and say, I wish there were more of these. This is not talked about enough. If this was talked about more, then maybe the startling fact that every 98 seconds someone is either sexually assaulted and/or raped would not have to be a reality. To put this into perspective, I've been talking for around 14 minutes, and that means 9 people have either been sexually assaulted and/or raped within this time frame. Does this scare you? Yeah, me too. It sure as hell scares me. It is time to rebrand your own rhetoric in regard to rape. It is time to sit back, take a pause, look at me as a human being, and then act. If I asked you to rewind this talk approximately 14 minutes, I would hope you would see a strong, confident woman who is not redefined by her story, her label, or your own predetermined judgment. Look at me, and do not feel bad for me, and do not feel threatened by me. Stop trying to find me a label. The only person who needs a label is, well, the rapist. If you can leave this conversation understanding a couple things, it is that this is not just a UMass issue. This is not just an Amherst issue. This is not just an issue on college campuses. This is a worldwide issue that we have softened for so many years. It is time to address rape as rape. Let's continue the conversation. Thank you.